Sure. Amen?
Amen.
Tonight we're going to be continuing our series on clear thinking. We're in part three. And last Sunday morning, the sermon was open hearts, open hands. And I used the verse from Matthew, the 12th chapter, the 31st verse. It says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And in that sermon, I said that it's our hearts, not our heads, that make the final determination whether we're going to be generous or not. And I said it all starts with the heart. Well, that's also true if you want to talk about having a change in your life. Yeah, we talked earlier about that. If you want to have a change in your life, it starts right here in your thinking. And you need some clear thinking about that. And after all, Romans 12 and 2 said, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But if you want that change to be sustained in your life, there has to be a change in the heart. And so, tonight I want to talk about, for a little while, thinking clearly about a change of heart. And we found, when I was looking for a good example, I found it in Luke, the 19th chapter. It's a good example of a change of heart. Read along with, you don't have to read out loud, it's there in your notes. But it says, Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through town. There was a man named Zacchaeus. He was one of the most influential Jews in the Roman tax collecting business, and he had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was just too short to see over the crowds. And so he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree beside the road so he could watch from there. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quickly come down, for I must be a guest in your home today. And Zacchaeus quickly climbed down, took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But, somebody said but.
But
the crowds were displeased. There's a sermon in there, Brother Diane. But the crowds were displeased. He had gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner, they grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood there and said, Lord, I give half of my wealth to the poor. If I overcharge people on their taxes, I will give it back to them four times as much. Jesus responded, salvation has come to this house today. For this man has shown himself to be a son of Abraham. And I, the son of man, son of humans, have come to seek and to save those like him. Those like him who are lost. It's a compelling story. It's made even more compelling by the fact that one chapter earlier, Jesus is ranting and raving about rich folk. And in that chapter before this, Jesus says, easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to get into heaven. And so, just a short while after Jesus made that statement, here he is going through town, and who does he encounter and have lunch with? A rich man. His one-on-one encounter with this man that kids. Jesus teaching about camels passing the eye needle is a teaching that really ought to unsettle most of us, because after all, if we're honest, isn't it true that all of us have wanted greater riches? Haven't all of us wanted greater prosperity? Haven't all of us wanted to have more material things than we have? Come on, let's be honest. And Jesus indicated it's very hard for a prosperous, self-reliant type of people to enter the kingdom of God. How do you think that's true? I thought about that when I was working on a lesson, and there's many reasons, but I came up with three top ones. The first one is what?
Pride.
Pride will keep people from God. You know why? Because pride will make you think you don't need God. And the Bible says that if we are to enter into the presence of God, we've got to come in simplicity and the humility of a child. And we got to come with this unabashed, unashamed cry of a little child to our heavenly parent. And we got to be able to willing to say to God, I don't want to live alone anymore. I don't want to do it on my own anymore. God, I need your help. And that takes humility to say that to God. People go through 12-step, no. He had a breaking will to say things like that. Is that right? Amen. And so proud, outward, successful types often have a hard time admitting that they need anything or anyone. Another reason would be false
security.
Yes, false security. You know how that works? People are doing well. People, let's put it this way. The temptation is to think, I'm awesome. Things are going well. And so when they get to thinking like that, they think, my money can buy me out of this trouble. Or my ability can work me out of this trouble. Or my mind can think me out of this trouble. My insurance can pay my way out of this trouble. I'm covered. Why should I need God? I'm secure. And so we get into that eat, drink, and be merry thing. And we remember how that turned out. Amen? And then the third reason I thought about this is it's very dangerous. What makes it very dangerous is false conclusions about righteousness. I'm going to ask you to guess that. A false conclusion about righteousness. Before I even get into this, let me just tell you, you do know what righteousness is, don't you? And maybe that's the problem. We don't know what righteousness is. Righteousness is not your conduct. That's holiness. Two different things. Righteousness is just about being in. Righteousness literally means right standing. Being in a right standing with God. That's what it literally means. Right standing. Your righteousness means you're in right standing with God. That's all that means. You know, all these religious terms that we had all these years, and they put all this stuff to them, it makes a lot more sense if you tell them what it means, doesn't it? But the temptation there is for prosperous people, if I'm so bad, why is life so good? Or what do you mean I need something fixed in my heart? Look at my life. Is that something about anybody in the news lately? It's for all these reasons that Jesus said it's easy for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And so with this great pronouncement in their mind, because remember, these people that are going through the city with Jesus had been with Jesus all along. So that's fresh in their mind. And so with this pronouncement, I mean, the followers of Jesus must have been standing on their tiptoes when Jesus encountered this crook, Zacchaeus. They had to be waiting with bated breath to see what was going to happen when Jesus had this one-on-one encounter with this rich man, Zacchaeus. And now I tell you, when I read the Bible sometimes, I like to let my imagination go. I like to visualize the scripture. And when I was seeing this story, I was thinking about Danny DeVito in a robe. You know, he's short. And I was thinking, can't you just see him, his eyes glancing, comes out of his eye, how his eyes are glancing, going through the city and things, because you have to understand, this man was the tax collector. Back then, like it is now, people don't like tax collectors. And so he's probably high, you know, he's probably, you know what the scripture says, a guilty man will run even when nobody's chasing him. That would have been him. Because he's probably thinking, you know, I'm about to run into somebody and they'll slip a dagger in my ribs. And so he's dodging stuff. He's trying to see Jesus. Finally can't find, he finally turns on him. Wait a minute, I'm not going to go up on the front line. And back here, I ain't going to get to see him because all these folks are a lot taller than me. How does this network this truth? And I can just see what's going on up there. Besides, I'll be safe. And so here's Zacchaeus. He shoots up this tree, climbs up the tree, sit down as far on the limb as safely possible. We don't want to get too far out. Some of us will cause that limb to break. But here he is after years of stealing, years of being an outcast in society, years of spiritual hunger, all these things that probably left him with ragged or a bit ragged around the edge. And think about this. His name is Zacchaeus. A thoroughly Jewish prominent name, which literally means righteous one. That's what Zacchaeus means. Can you imagine back then a tax collector being named righteous would be like the prostitute being named Chastity? I mean, the name and the character don't match. And so, and in those days, as a tax collector, it made him both a thief and a traitor. How do you say? Well, he was a thief because tax collecting was unregulated. Tax collectors charge you in whatever they wanted to charge you. And they get to keep all of it except that portion that they had to send on to Rome. That's how they got rich. Gouging you for taxes, the good people. And that's why he was a traitor too. Can you imagine a Jew collecting taxes for the oppressive Roman government? That made you a thief and a traitor. And also that's why obviously was the means of his wealth, because he was the chief tax collector. So he was taking it from the ones who were taking it from you. He was really stacking it up. And the Bible says that he was very rich. And so this man's chance of having a heart change that day and getting into the kingdom of God was very slim. You know, that whole camel through the eye of the needle thing. And this is where we stopped the story and started breaking it down. And trying to reflect on this thing point by point to get a clear thinking about a change of heart. Oh, Zacchaeus' heart got changed that day. And in order for that to happen, some things had to happen. Number one, in order for my heart to be changed like Zacchaeus, I must be open to the
invitation.
Because initiative of the gospel. The initiative of God. And you'll see why that word is used just a minute. When I say you got to be open to the initiative of God, what I mean is you got to be open to the idea that God is pursuing me and you. On this particular day, somehow Zacchaeus had realized that Jesus was coming to town, and Zacchaeus experienced that day the mercy of God. And Zacchaeus goes out of his way to find Jesus. I mean, he discovers that Jesus, and after he goes out of his way to find Jesus, he discovers that Jesus was looking for him the whole time. That's a miracle of grace right there. Amen? Before you ever thought of searching for God, God was already searching for you. Now, don't get me wrong. It's not that God didn't know where you was all along. It's just that you didn't know where God was. You didn't know that God was trying to get to know you, that God was trying to get you to respond to God's love and mercy and grace all along. So here's Zacchaeus who climbed up in the tree. I wonder how long it's been since he climbed the tree. If he looked like Danny DeVito, he ain't come on many trees, does he? And I imagine it was a little risky one, and I thought about that because, you know, a spirit of risk always accompanies the spirit of those who want to know more about Jesus. That's a risk. You've got to be vulnerable when you want to know more about Jesus. And beyond that, I think that Jesus was proud of Zacchaeus making that effort, seeking him. And so Jesus walks over to the tree and looks up and says, Zacchaeus, hurry down. I'm going to your house today. That's what theologians call the divine initiative. The divine initiative. When you decide that something in your life needs a change, when there's something that needs to be changed in your heart, you discover, like Zacchaeus, that God already knows your name. Already knows your name. God already knows your need. Amen? God is just waiting on you to make the first move, because God is not going to force God's will on you. But if you make the first move like Zacchaeus did and go looking for Jesus, God will definitely come to you. You will find that God was looking for you all along. And let me tell you something. Many folks in our community know what it's like to go through a time in their life when you've given up even thinking that you might want to have anything to do with, oh, that God might want to have anything to do with you. And yeah, we know about that. Amen? And so you need to hear loud and clear that God has never, ever, ever given up on you. It has never happened. You have never lived one day of your life when God has given up on you. And others may have given up on you. Mom and dad may have given up on you. Friends may have given up on you. But God has always been there around your tree. Amen? Searching, wanting, waiting, looking in the branches, shaking the branch every time to just to trying to get your attention. God's not going to force God's self on you. But God will do all kinds of things to try to get your attention. And right there at that tree is where that change of heart happened for Zacchaeus. It was when Jesus called him by his name, when Jesus reached out and invited himself to dinner, that was when things changed for Zacchaeus. And that's what it'll happen to you. God is always looking for you. God is always looking for you in your need. God knows your name. God's shaking your tree. And God wants you to know, if you say yes to him coming, you know, when I read this, I thought about Revelation, the 3rd chapter, in the 20th verse, which says, when Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." See, he's always knocking, he's always looking. And he said, if anyone open that door, he said, "I know your name. I'm knocking on the door of your heart. If you open that door, I'll come in and I'll sup with you and you with me." That's when Jesus called me by name. Here's this little short man on a tall tree, hated by everybody in town, and all of a sudden he finds himself in the center of God's attention. And he discovers that there's nobody else in this whole town loves or cares about him. God loves him. And God wants to have a relationship with him. What do you think it must have been like in that moment for him? Knowing you're the most hated person in town. And nobody wants to have anything. Everybody, all your people, because he was Jewish, all your people hate you because you're a thief and a traitor. And in those days, when you had a meal with somebody, that wasn't just going out to lunch with somebody. That was an intimate thing in that culture. I mean, it was a way of saying, I want to be close to you. I want a friendship with you. And this is the voice of God saying to this man who was out on the Lamb of Life. Friend, let's go have lunch. Let's go have lunch. That's how a heart change happens. You seek, you open yourself, and God will come to you. God moves in, and when God moves in, you find that Jesus is always there with welcoming arms. No matter who you are, no matter what's your past, no matter where you are on our life's journey, or even who you love, you get to know that God loves you, and God comes to you. God keeps coming to you. That's the point right here. God keeps coming to you. And God keeps extending God's love to you. Until you come out of that tree that you're in. And God was just bringing you. Amen?
Amen.
Zacchaeus was surprised that Jesus made him his agenda that day. I'd be surprised too, wouldn't you? It was shocking. He was surprised that Jesus would initiate it. Love towards him. So that brings us to number two. I must believe that God loves sinful people. You know, for those of us who have actually tasted God's mercy, God's grace, forgiveness, and all acceptance, we look at this and we go, good, yeah, I already knew this. But do you understand that there's a lot of people who don't know this? You are most fortunate. There are a lot of people in our community, in this city to this day, who don't know this. Either they've not heard about it, or they heard about it and just can't believe it. And if you dig into this passage, you discover a really dark part of this story going on. While one person is being forgiven, his past is being washed away, he's being reconciled with God, others are growing angry that Jesus would be so free with God's love. Isn't that what we've experienced? You have folks that are mad at the idea that God loves gay people. Mad! People who think what I'm doing right here in front of gay people and our allies is an abomination of God, to be so free with God's love over people like y'all. And it drives me batty that idiots believe that. I should get it done. I mean, look at the crowd. Verse 7 says, the crowds were displeased and they grumbled. That's an ugly picture, isn't it? When Jesus walks towards Zacchaeus, the rich crook, I think right before Jesus spoke his first words, the crowd just leaned in, licking their lips in anticipation of what Jesus is going to say. Obviously, Jesus is going to give him some hellfire and damnation right here, right? Obviously, Jesus is going to be, there's going to be a whole lot of woe to you and finger pointing right here. And so when the crowd heard, Jesus says, friend, come down. I'm having lunch with you today. They were livid. They were mad as hell. Amen? Ain't that like the church today? Ain't that just like the church today? I mean, they could not believe that Jesus would be so free with the love of God to extend it to somebody they call unworthy of. Some people believe that God just came in to make good people better. You know? He came for folks like them. And only them. You know what they say? Huh? Jesus said, I came to seek and save the lost. Those who are lost to my love. Those who are lost to the forgiveness, the acceptance, the grace of God. And so off goes the crowd in one direction, grumbling. Off goes Zacchaeus and Jesus to lunch. One man has just climbed down from a tree. The other man, 1 week later, would be nailed to a tree. This was a week before Jesus went to the cross. Zacchaeus' heart was changed that day. And though Zacchaeus, through his whole life, had just made one bad decision after another. I mean, he's made one wrong move after another. That's why he's the most hated man in town. But that day he did two things right, and it made a difference. What were the two things? First of all, he realized he needed God's help. He needed God's help. He realized he needed God's help. And we have to realize we need God's help. If we don't realize we need God's help, we'll never ask for it. Amen? We'll never ask for it. And so Zacchaeus, he had his hands full of stuff, but his heart was empty. And so all of his life, he paid attention to power, prestige, portfolios, and all that stuff, but he had neglected his own soul. But on this day, he realized what he really needed. And you might say, where did you get all that from? I don't see Zacchaeus realizing his own spiritual. Does the Bible really say that? It's a good question. I'm glad you asked it, by the way. I'm glad I helped you ask it. I want you to think about this. If you were a short man who was considered a traitor, and a fee. Would you be eager to go to a roadside parade? Think about that. Because this would be a perfect setting for a very unpopular man to just stay at home. Okay? Because in that crowd, chances are you're going to run into somebody you've stiffed. And they're going to stiff you too with a dagger through your ribs. Oopsies. And guess what? You could do it and nobody would know we did. In a crowd. You know? And so you're not going to want to be around all these people, are you? And so what do you suppose propelled Zacchaeus from the safe confines of his house that day into those streets with all those people he knew don't like him? What do you suppose tugged at his heart to seek out that one who spoke with such authority about God? It's my contention that the public seeking by Zacchaeus of Jesus, so much so that he wanted to see Jesus, that he was willing to climb, he was willing to go through that crowd and climb that tree. I would submit to you, that's a mission right there. He needed something. And he would take that kind of risk. He admitted that he needed Jesus. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand my teaching here. I'm not teaching against money or anything like that. Because Zacchaeus' problem was not prosperity. It wasn't even the money he had. His problem was he was trying to fill his life with something that only God could do. You know, we all have that little area in our life that we have a longing, and we don't know, some of us don't know what it is for. And so we do all kinds of stuff. Some of us do jewelry, try to feel it. Some of us shop, try to feel it. Some of us buy this and buy that, try to feel it. Some of us jump in relationships we shouldn't be in, trying to feel it. Because we're trying to feel something. What is it? What's his name? Augustine? It's the one who said that in each of us is a God-shaped vacuum. And he said what he meant by there's a place in you. God created you, and there's a place in you that's reserved for only God. And you have that longing for God. And when you don't know that longing for God, you try to fill it with all these other things, and nothing will satisfy it, because the only thing that can satisfy it is Jesus, is God. And so we go out and we search for. And in his case, went out searching for money and fame and portfolio and power and all that kind of stuff, and he was still in that place and had not been dealing. It was only when he got outside to go see Jesus that he had that change of heart there at that point. He had everything money could buy, but he sold himself short. No pun intended. But he was willing to trade his soul for all that other stuff. And he discovered, he had to come to realize, I need God's help. That was the first thing he did. He realized he needed God. The second thing is, he did something about it. He went seeking Jesus. He took the initiative. This is the thing. Let me just tell you this right now. Get it through your thick skull right now. God is not going to do for you what you can do for yourself. Because why would he? He's giving you the ability to do it. And until you do what you can do, don't expect God to do what only God can do. And when you do what you can do, that's the first step that unleashes God to do what God can do. You want to be blessed in your life financially? Do what you can do about it. And then ask God to do what only God can do. You want to be blessed in your life, health-wise? Do what you can do to take care of your health. And then ask God. Now, this is from some people away, okay? So I've all sort of this myself. But do you understand what I'm saying? God's not going to do for you what you can do for yourself, because God's already given you the ability. And so he did what he could do. He went seeking Jesus. I mean, he had no clue what that meant. All he knew is Jesus was going by and he wanted to see Jesus. But it was what he needed. You want to have some clear thinking about your heart change? You find it in Jesus. You need to seek Jesus There's something about Jesus that gives people the confidence to have a change of heart. And so Zacchaeus sought him out. His size, his pride, nothing else kept him back. I mean, he knew he needed help. He knew that he needed a change in life. And so he went to Jesus. There's a great verse in Jeremiah 29:13. I sort of paraphrased it, made it personal. The original verse goes like this. You will seek me, and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. And I thought about that song by Cyndi Lauper. You know, you remember, if you're lost and you look for me, you will find me time after time. That's what he's saying right there. And so I changed the pronouns to personalize it and make it personal to me. If I will seek God and find God, when I search for God, I'll find God when I search for God with all my heart. And I love this picture of Jesus going to Zacchaeus' house and everybody else sitting out there on the street looking in with disbelief. That's how a lot of church folks get a job. In disbelief. What are they doing? What are they doing? You wouldn't believe early on in this church's history what people thought went on. I think they thought we had sex on the altar. And, I mean, all kinds of nonsense. And not just this church, but all churches that started out as affirming churches like this. You wouldn't believe what people, and you know, I asked the preacher one time, this is when I was in Atlanta, what do you think going at our church? And he was just so foaming at the mouth, I mean, whatever, because it was one of those protests. And I just walked up to him and said, what do you think going at our church? And I happened to have a bullet, and I just pulled it in. You see anything in here as abomination? Maybe that's blah, blah, blah. I left him there, come and do his mouth. People staring in disbelief of what goes on. You know, that disbelief of, why would Jesus go into the house with a Tory sinner like Zacchaeus? That was the question. There's only one answer to it, by the way. Jesus will enter wherever he's welcome. That's why he's not at most of their church. That one came out wrong. Because he did not welcome at most of their church. Because if he walked through the door, he wouldn't look like them. You're going to tell me a brown-skinned Jew from the Middle East walking in one of the churches today that looked like a Palestinian would be welcomed in a robe and sandals? Come on. I'm just saying, saints. I don't know where we get this blue-eyed Jesus from with blonde hair. It ain't so. I mean, Jews blonde dye their hair now. It ain't really that color. Back then, I've always wondered, what did you think of when Revelation said he had eyes like balls of fire, feet like burnished brass, and hair like ram's wool? That sounds like more like some of my folks than y'all. I'm just saying. But Jesus will go wherever he's welcome. Of all the people in the crowd that day, you almost have to scratch your head and say, why did Zacchaeus pop on Jesus' radar screen? Come on. I think it's because Jesus knew that Zacchaeus was the hungriest person in that crowd that day. He was the most open and the most ready to have his heart changed by an encounter with Jesus Christ. That's why he popped up on the screen. I hadn't thought about this. You're going to get this one free, name and notes. Every morning, you wake up, you pop up on the radar screen. All you got to do is be hungry. If you want to have an experience with God every day, all you have to do is be hungry. because every time you wake up, you pop up on the radar screen as well. Amen? When you look at the story, he became a brand new person. We don't know what Jesus discussed on lunch with that kid, but it must have been one hell of a lunch. That's all I can say. Because immediately after lunch, he jumps up and says, wow. It was one of those lunches where it was clear that the sheep had found the shepherd and the shepherd had found his lost sheep. Because something had shifted in Zacchaeus' heart, in that selfish tax collector's heart. There was a transformational moment. And the first thing he out of his mouth is Lord. You know what the word Lord means? It means leader, it means boss, it means king. So at that moment, he's no longer thinking of Caesar as king. He's thinking of Jesus as king. Woo! Hallelujah. And so he says, Jesus, basically saying, Jesus, you're my new leader. I'm going to give half of what I have to the poor. If I robbed anybody in my tax, isn't that a great idea? You wouldn't have what you have if you didn't rob somebody. If anybody in my tax, I'm going to pay them back with unbelievable interest. And I think the servants of Zacchaeus must have fainted right on the spot right there. Dang, they're not used to this from this man. And you know, standing right before them was a brand new Christian. There's a man named Walter Rauschenbusch. I think that's how his name was. Walter Rauschenbusch, who says right there at that moment was when the camel passed through the eye of the needle. And Jesus was glad about it and cheered it up. Right there was when the camel passed through the eye of the needle. It was a great moment. Amen? One last quick point, rather. I must never give up. Oh. Y'all got that wrong after this little bit out there. We're in the seasons of polls, right? I bet you if you've taken a poll in that city of that day and asked those people, everybody in the city, who is the most unlikely person in this city to have their life made new and to be rightly connected to God? I bet you the poll would have almost been like Saddam Hussein's election. It would have been 100% unanimous. They'd have said that doggone, no good tax collectors out there. There's no hope for him. And yet, who is it that had their life changed that afternoon in Jericho? Who would have knew that Zacchaeus would emerge from his cocoon as a new person? I saw cartoon. Two caterpillars was just inching along. They looked up and they saw a butterfly flying way over there. And one of them said to the other one, "You'll never catch me up there in one of these things. You never know what's going to happen to me." We have people in this church who just 5, 3, 2 years ago, Father said, "You never catch me in church again." And what they really were saying, "You never catch me giving my heart to Jesus." And what that really means is, they didn't beat up the church. What that really meant is, somebody told them God didn't love them. Someone turned them off to God. But somehow the butterfly that took place in their life. There was a metamorphosis, a change happened that only God could work within him heart. It took place in them and it happened to be here. Let me just ask you, who are you about to give up on? Who in your life are you about to give up on? Is it a spouse? Is it a friend? Is it a relative? Co-worker? Let me ask you. Let me make it personal, more personal than that. Are you about to give up? Are you about to give up? Are you at the end of your rope and you're about to give up? The poet said, "Jesus is a tremendous love who pursues us with love. As I close, I want you to imagine this. I said it just a few moments ago. Jesus has you on his radar screen. Every day you wake up. And in the presence of God's unconditional love, you are Jesus' complete agenda. He didn't have any other agenda but and Judy, Eric, Rob, Diana, if you call your name out, you're his completely agenda. And he's pursuing you with his love. And he wants to enter your life, recreate your heart, so that you have a change of heart, so that you know that you can lean on him, that you can trust in him. He wants to make that thing fresh and new for you every day. He wants your life to be so every day you wake up, you will know that no matter what's going on in your life that day, you have popped up on the radar screen of the Almighty. If you could get that picture in your mind, it would change your life. I hope it's clear for you, so that you'll be like those who never, ever give up. After all, thinking about a clear heart means learning to lean on Jesus. Because there you'll find more power than you ever dreamed. Just learning to lean on Jesus.